Okay, we're back.
Yes, we are. We're back.
Another week. And this week you picked Michael Curtiz.
That's right.
All right.
Yes.
You say is your hero.
Yeah, he is right? My hero. Now, he's one of my heroes. One of my filmmaking heroes.
Why is he one of your heroes?
Because he is the anti-auteur director.
Okay.
By that I mean is that he has made masterpieces in several genres.
Mm-hmm.
But if you didn't see the credit, you wouldn't know by the cinematic signature that it was the same person behind the camera in each situation.
Right.
You see? Yeah. And so that's the anti-auteur theory. And
now, real quick, can I interrupt you? Can you define the auteur theory for our audience very briefly?
Well, the auteur theory, and it is a theory, which means it's a fact that can't ever really be proven, is that every director who knows what he's doing behind the camera leaves his signature in some way on the film that he makes. Hitchcock, you can see it throughout. You can see it with John Ford's work. You can see it with Howard Hawks' work. You can see it with Ida Lupino's work. But with Curtiz, you can't. Beyond that, the other thing that bothers me, not in a great way that it keeps me up at night, but there are no books on Curtiz's work.
I know.
He has never been cited for his expertise because of the lack of an auteur's signature.
Yeah, and one more thought on the auteur theory. It's pretty much the main theory from which most film criticism is approached these days.
Yeah, so. The bad thing about it is now there are people who have no body of work. I mean, young filmmakers who are just making one film that are defining themselves as auteurs, which, of course, is contrary to what the entire meaning of the term is. Because to be an auteur, you have to have a body of work. It's simple as that. Anyway.
So, Gus, what is your favorite Curtiz film?
You know, it's hard to pick because he's got so many acknowledged masterpieces. I would say, for a variety of reasons, that I think Yankee Doodle Dandy.
Okay. Interesting.
And the reason
for
that,
I thought you were going to say Casablanca.
But I love Casablanca, and it would be probably my second choice.
Okay.
The reason that I say Yankee Doodle Dandy is it's a more difficult job to have brought off. It's sentimental.
Mm-hmm.
And sentiment is a very difficult thing to do. It's a biography, which is also difficult to do. And it's a musical. So he's got three genres working together, three difficult genres that he somehow put together completely that works every time you see it. At least every time I see it, it works for me.
Okay, well, my favorite is Adventures of Robin Hood, which I think is just the purest, greatest adventure movie ever made. I think Curtiz, I was recently watching another movie with a lot of the same cast, Dodge City, which is a Curtiz Western.
Yes.
Again, he transcends genres, you know. It's not a great Western, but again, it's a great adventure movie, right? And he has a real sense of that. And So I think that it's just so cinematically powerful and fun. It's just pure fun with, you know, my favorite scene is when Errol Flynn bursts through the doors, and what a grand entrance with the deer on his shoulders. And it's got, he's a good director of actors too, with Claude Rains, or at least a good organizer of actors, you know. So anyway, that's my favorite. Do you like the film?
Oh, I totally love the film. I fully agree. As a matter of fact, I saw it about 5 or 6 weeks ago. It was on TCM, and I watched it and thought, this is the textbook for the perfect adventure movie.
Right,
I've never understood why other directors they were making so many Robin Hoods anyway, didn't watch that, and with some variations, you can't copy it shot for shot, but with some variations, stay with that format. Because it works so well.
Yeah.
They keep trying to update the attitudes of the film and stuff like that.
No.
The other thing that he was good at, or the studio maybe was the thing, was casting.
Yeah.
The casting always seems so on the money. You know, James Cagney as George M. Cohan.
Yep.
Errol Flynn.
Yep.
I mean, that was a role that was originally intended for James Cagney.
Yeah, I heard
and
that.
And then Errol Flynn got
Flynn's
it, which was perfect.
Again, Claude Rains from, you know, he used him perfectly in Casablanca.
Yes.
And then here, he's perfect. And Basil Rathbone is perfect as the villain. So good as the villain. And Olivia de Havilland is
Maid
Marian.
Perfect,
Marian.
Yes.
But yeah, it's like it's a perfect cast. What is your what do you?
Well,
think
we got to talk about Casablanca. We
can't let Casablanca go. Fine.
Well, the reason, as I said, I didn't select it as my favorite is because the one thing it has going for it, which helps it, is its cynicism.
Okay.
You know,
okay.
It's, so that helped. That's why I said when you're dealing with a musical, the sentimentality to transcend that, mm-hmm. to me, is a greater feat than when cynicism. You bring cynicism, you already have that working for you, and you just bring it forward.
Yeah.
Know? But nevertheless, Casablanca is one of my all-time favorite movies.
Yeah.
Because again, as you were saying about Robin Hood, everything in it is right.
It's perfect.
The entire cast is right. Claude Rains has become my role model.
Uh-huh.
As Reynold.
Yeah.
And the whole attitude, the tone, the narration.
Yeah.
Works for it. There's something about the narration that sounds cynical as well.
Yeah.
And so everything, it kind of has the tone that this is a crock of shit.
Yeah.
But we're bringing it off.
Yeah.
And they do. That's why I love it.
I thought it was interesting after watching Dodge City, I picked up my copy of Andrew Saris's, what's it called? The History of
American Film.
American Film, right. American Cinema.
Yeah.
And if you guys don't know, this is a major American critic who wrote a book called American Cinema,
yes.
based on the auteur theory, and pretty much classifying all of the major directors as like the greats and then the, you know,
yes.
to the less. And I thought, what does he have to say about Cortez, right?
Yes, yes.
And I look, and of course Cortez is in the like mildly acceptable category,
yes,
right?
Yes.
But I did like that he said Casablanca is the greatest, he admitted Casablanca is the greatest argument against the auteur theory ever,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes,
Which is interesting, because it is an absolute masterpiece.
Well, you know, Pauline Kael once referred to it as a shallow masterpiece.
Nice.
And I think it's totally accurate.
Yeah.
You know, who says a masterpiece has to be deep?
That's right,
you know?
Yeah.
And so that's one of the things I really like about it. You know, when you ask about underrated films.
Yeah.
I think so many of his films are underrated.
His career is underrated.
Yes, his whole career is underrated. He was a character. So I don't have a single film that I can say, just to answer your question directly. What do you think was his most underrated?
I'll just pick another. It's another adventure film, but it's one that I've loved since I was a kid, and I continue to watch over and over again, is Captain Blood, which I think
is still
the best pirate film ever made.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's one that gets passed over and it's not acknowledged as a great pirate film or a great swashbuckler or a great adventure film, but it's perfect again.
And again, that's one of those that, one, I keep wondering why that story isn't remade,
mm-hmm.
and two, why the format or formula that he established with that picture isn't reused by other directors to make adventure films of this sort.
Right.
You know, like that. And once again, he had Errol Flynn.
Yeah,
you know, who was the quintessential swashbuckler, maybe motion picture's greatest adventure actor. Because of his looks, because of his athleticism, because of everything like that. We've had other actors who can do it, but they didn't have Michael Curtiz to lead them.
I agree. They worked together, I don't know how many times, on tons of films. Western swashbucklers, and I think they even made some films that were like they made one called something Commander, Dive Commander with Fred Murray.
Yes,
so
yes,
they even
went
outside the adventure genre.
Sure. And he made musicals with Doris Day.
Oh yeah. That's how diverse his career is.
Yes.
What do you think is his most overrated film?
I can't think of it.
See, that's the thing, is his films are not rated enough to be overrated.
They were never praised enough, and even the ones that are praised as masterpieces, he was never credited for them, in the sense that when they talk about, and everybody likes Robin Hood, everybody likes Casablanca, a lot of people like the one I mentioned.
Yeah, Yankee Doodle Dandy.
But they never refer to Michael Curtiz. They'll talk about the stars, they'll talk about the format, they'll talk about everything, but not that it's all guided by Michael Curtiz, which is the absurdity of all of this.
Someone, like you said, still needs to write a book, a scholarly book about his entire
body
career.
Of work. Yes, like, yes, yes.
Because there's so much there.
There's a lot about his character and his personality.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he was from the period when what we call the autocratic director.
Mm-hmm.
This is when the studio system was in place, and the director was the aristocrat boss on the set. And so there are a lot of stories. Plus, also, he's famous for his malapropisms because he was from Hungary. And English was maybe a third or fourth language for him. And he used the language sonically, not literally.
Right.
So he would refer to things as the pinochle of his career. You see things like that. He also was tough on actors. There's a very funny story of a character actor that he didn't like. The guy was in the picture, and this was like the 23rd day of shoot. And he said to the actor, he gave the actor direction, and he said, back up, back up, back up. And the actor kept going back. And he says, now you're out of the goddamn frame. Go home.
Nice. I love that.
His direction.
That's awesome. Yeah. He gets, like you said, it, but unfortunately, that's mostly what they mention when they talk about Cortese. The other thing that I love about Cortese, and I take this as a personal inspiration as a filmmaker, is the pace that he worked at, because he, for a while there, he made an average of 3 features a year
right,
which
right.
is the pace that I would like to work at. So
I just read and listened to a really interesting interview about his last film, which was John Wayne, The Comancheros.
Okay.
That was his last picture. And I belong to the Film Noir group or foundation, and they send stuff through the internet for me. And one of the things they did was they sent an interview with Stuart Whitman.
Okay.
And he was talking about that picture. And he said, for his role, he went over to Michael Curtiz. And Michael Curtiz told him that he couldn't cast him. He sent him to speak to John Wayne. And John Wayne said, yeah, you got a part. Like that. And the sad thing about that film is that I guess Curtiz didn't have a chance to really fully direct it. Mm. Wayne apparently directed most of it. Because,
was he sick?
Yes, he was so ill at the end there. Apparently, he had been diagnosed with cancer like 4 years earlier. And there was this understanding between his wife and his doctor not to tell him. And today that sounds
ridiculous. Yeah.
But it turned out to be a good thing, because since he didn't know it, he maintained his pace of work, and he worked for 4 years making these films. And suddenly, one day, they did tell him. And he said, he was angry that he wasn't told at the beginning. And then he asked, I think, how many films did I make? And they said, 9 pictures. And he says, then it was worth not telling me.
Nice.
And apparently, about 2 weeks after the shoot was ended with Comancheros, he passed on.
Oh.
Yeah, like that. So that's, give you the beginning, we have to give you the end of his story. But anyway, looking at the Comancheros, that's quite a good film.
I haven't seen that one.
If Wayne must have picked up the rhythms of Cortese's shooting, because it feels like a Cortese film all the way through.
Yeah.
Wherein the film that two films John Wayne directed, one was The Alamo, the other was The War
Green
Picture,
Beret.
The Green Berets, they don't have that kind of pace at all. So I have to assume that he followed Cortese's pattern and maybe his preparation for the film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's just the diversity of his work. Like, while we're talking, I'm thinking Mildred Pierce.
Mm. Oh,
geez,
God.
Louise.
Yes.
He got the crime noir thing
down. In there.
Right? Even, I love White Christmas, because it does exactly what it needs to do, you know? And he's able to just transcend.
Actually, if I was to think, I hadn't thought of that, but if I was to name an underrated picture, I would say it was White Christmas.
Yeah, White Christmas is so spot on. So anyway, I hope that now, after watching this, that you will pay attention to the name Cortese, because
you're Netflix or whatever, put in his name and pull up anything. I guarantee you'll be absolutely satisfied by it. And more than that, for young filmmakers, look at his work and study it. I think we can all learn something from watching and studying Michael Cortese's work.
I agree. So next week, we are going to discuss Stanley Kubrick.
Okay. Along the way, we have to discuss the Academy Awards.
Oh, yes.
Nomination.
Maybe we'll do the Academy Awards and our best 5 films of the year.
Together.
We'll combo those.
Yes.
Okay.
Sometime or other, we're going to have to talk about actors. Underrated actors, overrated actors.
I want to cover actors as well.
Yeah.
Their careers, not just filmmakers, not just directors. All right. Well, we will see you next week.
Absolutely.